Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today, inshallah, we're going to discuss the security in routing layer, or the most common security protocol in this layer, which is the IPsec. So, at the beginning, I would like to just put this in perspective of all what we have studied so far. So the big picture, which I always try to make it clear, is that first we have, of course, if we map all the security protocols that we have discussed so far to the TCP/IP layered stack. So of course, we have the network access. We have the network access layer, right? And on top of that, we have the routing layer, which we will discuss today. On top of this, we have transport layer, and then application layer. Okay, so to map this to security protocols, here we have discussed the extensible authentication protocol and the 802.1x to provide the security services for physical ports, to provide all the basic services, including encryption, integrity, authentication, and all of this, for either a physical port, or in case of wireless, we also discussed WPA, and WPA2, or RNS, to provide also wireless security services for logical protocols in that case. Okay, so that's for network access layer. Of course, here we have the IPsec, which we will discuss today, and we will try to motivate why we need IPsec if we have transport layer protocols, like, for example, security protocols. Yani, here we have SSL or TLS, or we have SSH. Okay, so these security protocols, they provide security services application to application, right? From the transport layer perspective, right? So even the TCP header is not going to be encrypted, okay? So they provide application to application security services. Of course, here in the application layer, we discussed lower Kerberos, which provides security services for one application in a big distribution system, using the concept of ticketing, remember, and the user authentication and all of this. So these are all the security protocols that we have discussed and how to map them to the TCP, the different TCP/IP layers. I would have hoped, actually, that the book goes through these security protocols in that perspective and provides either top-down or bottom-up approach, similar to what we have discussed in Network One. So we take, for example, network access, we discuss all the security protocols, we take routing and we discuss all the security, and so on. Or top down, okay? So either way, but unfortunately the chapters are, you know, jumping back and forth between the layers. So that's why I thought putting this high level picture should give you some perspective. So now, I mean, if we have SSL or TLS, okay? So why do we need IPsec? Why do we need to provide security from the routing layer, since we have SSL or TLS, right? So SSL or TLS, as I said, they provide application to application security services, right? So providing the application, providing the security services between two end applications does not provide enough security for the network infrastructure. Okay, so in other words, so you have, so in other words, if you have a host, okay, this host actually runs many applications, right? So these applications, if they use, for example, HTTP or SSL or TLS, which works on top of TCP, then this one uses SSL or TLS or whatever, which works by default over TCP, right? So if this application, for example, uses UDP, okay, without TLS, okay, so this application still runs over on this host, and for some reason or another, it does not provide it does not use any of the TLS or SSH or something like that. That's possible. We have applications like this, right? The problem is, if you have a network infrastructure here, okay, this application could very well be used to provide what we call a network injection. Okay? So you can use network. In fact, even you can use hatta SSL application if you gain control to one application, for example, you can inject some traffic into the network, and this kind of network injection, it actually injects some kind of routing layer messages, like, for example, routing advertisement, route updates, things like that. So these messages, if they get into the network, they can corrupt the network in many ways. Okay? So again, providing security services application to application is not enough to secure the network infrastructure, the routers themselves, the routers or the network firewalls or something like this. Okay? So that's why we need to provide tunneling services from the routing layer point of view, which is mandatory to protect not by the application in that case, but the network infrastructure, all the routers, all the switches inside the network itself. So that's what we need to discuss. And this is like a overall picture of what we have discussed so far and how we map it to the. I said before you just enter, I said that I would have hoped we discuss these security protocols in the order of the layers, taking like a bottom-up approach or top-down, so that we can have this full picture in our minds while we go through the layers one by one. But unfortunately, the book doesn't do that. The book actually jumps from one layer to another. Okay. Right. So we studied the network access. We studied the network access security in two different chapters. Okay, and in between, actually, we discussed TLS. So it would be consistent to just provide first network access security or physical port security using 802.1x or extensible authentication protocol, and then provide all the logical port security for the case of wireless using WPA and RNS and so on. And then we get to the IPsec, and then we get to that, yeah. Or going from top down, doesn't matter. You have a question?
In IPsec, security is used only to protect the data as related to the network, or it can, like, for all data?
We'll discuss that. The routing layer provides service in what level? Host-to-host communication or network-to-network communication? Okay? Regardless of the application, yes. Right? So when I use, like, for example, a VPN or IPsec for a particular host, by default, all the applications on that host are secure, right? With some policies, we'll talk about that, with some specific policies, because just the fact that you have VPN, it doesn't mean that you have restrictions for all the applications running to go through that tunnel or to go through that VPN.
Yes. Yes.
So we can bypass, we'll talk about that. This is what we refer to as security policies or IPsec policies. Okay, so we'll talk about this, the layer. So I hope this gives you a good snapshot of what we have discussed so far. Any questions?
This is the protocol in network.
Right. So IPsec is the predominant standard for providing security services from the routing layer, from the network layer point of view. Okay, and we said that's very important to secure the network infrastructure. Okay? Yeah, that's exactly. So at the beginning, we have this RFC just which was provided by IETF to just lay out the standards for IP version 4 and IP version 6 and providing some security services from the routing layer point of view. So this document just lays out the overall picture of IPsec and provides some pointers to some, you know, documents for IPsec. IPsec, in fact, is not covered in just one document. It's covered in actually many, many, many documents. Okay? And there are over maybe five to seven different RFCs to just cover the standards for IPsec. So there is standard document for APS, the standard document for AH, the standard document for the policies, the standard document for the internet key exchange, remember IKE, and there are so many documents, and we will talk about some of these. Of course, IPsec itself can be covered in one course, but we here will just give enough idea, I think, to some level of details, not just not very abstract, but to some level of details as well. Hamad, I hope you can hear us.
Yes, I can.
Okay, good. All right, so IPsec provides the capability to secure communication across LANs, and by LANs here we mean a private network or edge network to edge network. So we have, of course, so many edge networks, right? And we have the core network infrastructure. And here we have networks. So IPsec can provide the security services from one host on one network to one host on another network through the VPN tunnel. Or it can actually, this is not a host in that case, it can provide this security service between one router here and one router. And router includes also like firewalls, network firewalls. Okay? So in that case, all the hosts, they go through this default gateway, and there is one common VPN tunnel between these two routers or two firewalls. Okay? So in that case, the tunnel is used to secure all the LAN, the entire LAN, which means all the hosts, okay, on this LAN. Mafhouma keda? So IPsec provides the capability to provide the security services or secure communication across a LAN or private and public WANs. And private or public WANs, we mean that we can, like, to secure two offices, assume like this is Microsoft offices. This is Microsoft Office 1, this is Microsoft Office 2, for example. So in that case, if you want these two offices to communicate securely, of course, so one choice is just to build your own private network, which means that you have your own infrastructure.
Yeah.
Okay, so in that case, you guarantee that this private network is not, it's not going to be compromised because you built this network infrastructure yourself and you can secure it. Okay, but typically that's not the case. Okay, it's hard, right? So so instead of doing this, what typically happens is that we rely on the internet. So we use the infrastructure of the internet, yet provide some kind of a tunneling service. Okay. To hide all the communication happening between these two offices over the internet infrastructure, okay? So that's what more commonly happens. So private WANs here refer to the fact that you have your own private infrastructure. Public WANs means that you can use IPsec over the public internet to provide security services. Do you have a question?
Yeah, what's the difference? So I still don't get the difference between this and TLS, for instance, because it also...
TLS provides security for one particular... So this is a host, okay? This host has many application endpoints. Okay? So TLS provides communication between this and another application endpoint. Okay? So one application here and one application here provides end-to-end communication. Even TLS header is not it's not going to be encrypted or secured or anything, right? So in that case, as we said before, if you provide application-to-application security, there's no guarantee that these security services are going to be used for all the applications running on that host, which means that other applications here, they are not forced to use any security services, in which case these applications can in fact be used to inject traffic into the network infrastructure, corrupting the network infrastructure altogether, using what we call a network injection. They inject route advertisement, they inject ICMP messages, you see what I mean? So they can corrupt the entire network infrastructure, okay? So that's the problem with it. So that's why we need to provide another security level at the network layer to secure the network infrastructure. Okay, so that's, so in terms of examples, we secure branch offices connectivity over the internet, which is what we have discussed. We secure remote access over the internet. So again, if you are traveling or you are at home, yet you want to connect to a QU to get access to some of the servers inside QU, then you can in fact use IPsec to create some kind of tunnel between your host, regardless of all the applications, regardless of the applications on your host. Okay, your host and the servers inside QU. And we'll talk about what are the modes and what are the options when it comes to building that tunnel between a host and a network. Okay, so you can, again, network layer provides communication between host to host or network to network or host to network, right? Yes. So all of these are from the from the routing layer. Type, enhancing electronic commerce security. So electronic commerce, when we hear electronic commerce, this is a website, so TLS is enough. I mean, why do we need IPsec? Well, electronic commerce systems, these are ecosystems they are not only, you know, web services and you buy from the, like Amazon. So imagine مثلا, Amazon, it's an e-commerce website at the end of the day. But Amazon, it's a complete system that includes supply chain, includes infrastructure, includes inventories, it includes many, many things. So they have many distributed servers in the back end, right? So securing this infrastructure for the e-commerce is what is referred to here, right? So not only like the website, because the website only, it's an app. Right? App using SSL will be enough, right? When it comes to the app. But actually the e-commerce system is a lot more than just, you know, the web service, okay? So, of course, like all the other protocols from the different layers, IPsec will provide, of course, the basic security services to provide, first and foremost, encryption, okay, or confidentiality, provide integrity, provides authentication, right? And it provides all the IVs or initial vectors for, you know, all the pseudo-random functions and all of this, which are required, and also, of course, key management, right? So, actually, we'll discuss this at the end. This is IKE. And IKE itself is a very complicated standard on its own. So we'll discuss this at the end of the chapter. Type. So the principal feature for IPsec is that it can encrypt and or authenticate all the traffic of the IP level, which means on the level of the IP, which is for the entire host or for the entire network, if needed. Okay, Thus, all distributed applications, include all the applications that are running on that host, they will use these security services by default. So either by, if they use TLS, fine. If they don't use any security, they will also go through the tunnel, which means that they are forced to be secure in that case. And that's what typically happens if you are traveling and you want to access QU. So you have to abide by the QU policy that you have to connect through IPsec or VPN. In that case, you cannot just, you know, access any services from QU without having VPN.
We said that in the TLS that we can make it in the operating system.
Right. 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 If you do it from the operating system, then any application that uses TCP, it will by default use TLS, right? But TCP is not the only transport layer protocol. So you could actually use UDP, in which case you are not forced. Application that uses UDP is not forced to use TLS in that case, okay? But that's a good question. Okay, so these are the types of services that IPsec provides. In fact, there is great flexibility, and that's why the standard is very complicated. So we will discuss this in more details later, but basically you have the IP payload, and you have the original IP header. By original IP header here, we mean the typical IP header that we are all used to, which includes destination address, source address, IPs, yeah, destination IP address, source IP address, and all the TTL stuff, hub count, things like that. All the standard stuff that we are used to. Why we say original IP? Well, that's interesting because in IPsec, you may have to actually provide another IP header. We call it outer IP, okay? And why is that? Because there is a specific mode inside IPsec which requires the fact that if you provide ESP header, and by ESP we'll talk about ESP, it's called encryption header standard protocol, okay? So this, in fact, requires the entire payload and the header to be all encrypted, okay? Unlike the TLS. Here we have two modes, and that's why this is complicated. We have two modes. So there's one mode that this ESP is in fact after the IP header, and there is another mode that this ESP is before, okay? So what is the problem with this? The problem with this is that if it's here, then it's fine. We'll encrypt the IP payload, and we'll talk about this trailer later, okay? We'll encrypt the IP payload and the trailer, and everything will be fine, right? Because this IP header is exposed. In that case, it's not encrypted, so all the routers, they can do their function, right? Because the routers are based, or they rely in their function on this IP header, right? That's how they do routing. Yes. So they need to at least read the destination address, TTL, and all of this, right? So if this header is exposed, then it's fine. The problem with this, which is what we call the tunnel mode. In the tunnel mode format, the ESP header is in fact after the IP header. And in that case, this ESP header requires all this to be encrypted, including the header. So what do we do with the routers then? Because routers will not be able to read the header to provide routing, okay? So in that case, we provide the minimum information for routing in what we call a outer IP header, okay? We require the minimum information for the routers to do their functions, okay? So it's like only the destination address, that's what they want. The destination address and the TTL. If they decrement TTL and it's zero, then you know what to do, okay? And the destination address so that they can match and they can find in order to route the packet accordingly. Because remember, whether you have IPsec or you don't have IPsec, remember this, IPE and IP version 6, both are connectionless, unreliable, okay? So that's why discussing security techniques and services in different layers, you have to sometimes do some special customization based on the characteristics of the protocol in this layer, right? So for example, TLS works on top of TCP, and there is an end-to-end connection using TCP. So providing security services over a connection-oriented protocol, okay, is different from providing security services on a connectionless, unreliable protocol. And we'll talk about this in details to really appreciate what are the implications of providing security services over IP, which is inherently connectionless and unreliable. Okay, طيب. So this is the tunnel mode. Is this the only mode? No, there is, as we said, there are two modes, okay? And in fact, the ESP function can be divided into two functions. So we'll talk about all these different combinations. طيب. So as we said, we can provide tunnel service or tunnel mode, okay, to secure entire network to entire network communication, okay? In that case, actually here the traffic could be unprotected. The traffic inside this network is a private network or edge network. We are not restricting the traffic inside this network to be protected in any way, right? It's like the example that we just talked about. So you are using normal HTTP without TLS. You can do that, okay? But sorry, if you want to go over that tunnel, if you want to go out, then you have to go through the tunnel and you have to use IPsec in that case. Type. There are some advantages and disadvantages. So this is the other mode that, or this is the other scenario, that you have a host, okay? This host might be, for example, Leif is traveling and he's having his laptop and he wants to connect to the network. So then in that case, his laptop has to perform IPsec, okay? So the IPsec in that case runs on the host itself, yes. Right? IPsec, by the way, is pretty heavy in terms of computational capabilities. It's pretty heavy, right? All these tunneling services and encryption on IKE and all of this is pretty heavy. So if you run it on the entire network, so in that case, this is a firewall or a router, okay, that runs IPsec for the entire traffic of the internet, okay? So in that case, the advantage is that all hosts on this network, they are secure by default to go out, okay? And also, all these hosts, they don't have to run IPsec, okay? Which means that the overhead on these hosts is lighter. They don't have to run all the complexities of IPsec. But if you want to have a host accessing a remote network through IPsec, then the host has to run IPsec, in which case all these components of IPsec have to be run inside the host, okay? طيب. So as we said here, we have different combinations. So we'll talk about that. So some of the benefits of IPsec, when IPsec is implemented in a firewall or a router, it provides strong security that can be, in that case, leveraged by all the hosts, as we said, without having the host incur the overhead of running all the IPsec services, which left some of the complexity from these hosts. Meshi? IPsec in a firewall is resistant to bypass if all traffic from outside must use the... So just the fact that this IPsec is running on the firewall, by the way, it doesn't mean that all the traffic has to go through that tunnel, okay? So IPsec also includes a very important component, which is the policy database. In the policy database, you can, in fact, select a certain type of traffic to be bypassed, okay? To go through direct IP without having to go through the IPsec over IP, okay?
So I think it is something, the opposite of SSH. Like SSH, you need to port forward that applications to go through a tunnel, where now it is the default mode is to go through that.
But again, SSH is the problem is that SSH is application to application, okay? Yes. So you can select, you choose whether this application uses SSH or not,
yes.
Okay? Here you don't have a choice. Here you don't have a choice unless you use the policy database.
So you have the choice to...
The policies of IPsec, okay, gives you that choice that certain type of traffic may in fact go outside the tunnel. But at least you have control. You will have control to select what type of traffic goes outside the tunnel, what type of traffic goes inside the tunnel. Okay? Like for example, as an example, if I see the type of traffic that is coming is TLS over TCP, okay, so why repeat the work? It's already secure. Tunneled through application to application. So why do I have to provide another level of key management and all of this and encryption? It's already encrypted, okay? So I can select way to bypass this traffic. But the example that we just talked about is that one application is UDP, is not enforcing security as such. So in that case, no. You have to go inside that. It's not by your choice. It's by my choice, the network choice, okay? So that I can protect the network infrastructure from this type of traffic. مفهوم كده؟ واضح؟ Okay. So IPsec is below the transport layer, and so it is transparent to the applications, as we said. So hence, there's no need to change software or user, okay? So there's no need to provide that TLS in the kernel of the operating system and this and that, okay? You don't have to have this. If you have IPsec, خلاص, all the applications are by default secure, okay? IPsec can provide security for individual users if needed. So we can see from the policies that we can actually set the policies such that all traffic coming from a particular user, okay, they can go through the tunnel, or particular they can bypass things like that. Okay, so the policies can be defined based on different criteria, based on, for example, the destination address, or a particular user traffic, or a combination of a destination address, port number, things like that. Okay. So IPsec can play a vital role in the routing architecture requires for internetworking, right? So by IPsec, we secure all the routing related messages which are very, very important. And that's why we said that these are the messages that protect the network infrastructure. Because if somebody performs any network injection, this can damage the entire network infrastructure, right? So all router advertisements, okay, that are coming possibly from unauthorized users, IPsec will protect against that. A router seeking to establish a neighbor relationship with a router. Remember using the neighbor adjacency in the routing protocol, whether IP version 4 or IP version 6. IP version 6 in particular, IP version 6 uses a ICMP version 6, which uses neighbor advertisement and solicitation from the network layer point of view. Okay, so these are special types of messages that routers they exchange, or sometimes nodes they exchange, in order to establish some adjacency and perform the routing protocol. And these types of messages are also secure. Redirect messages comes from a router to which the initial IP packet was sent. So all the redirect, so if you are redirecting from one website to another website or something like this, these types of messages are also secure. Or route updates, of course, which contain some metric, and based on that you can update your routing table. All of these are all the routing messages, including dynamic routing protocols and ICMP. ICMP, remember ICMP, طبعاً. Internet Control Messaging Protocol, which are used for troubleshooting and sometimes for IP version 6. They are using for IP configuration, and they are using for providing also some adjacency establishment. So all these types of messages are secure. So these are part of the documents that IPsec standards include. Part, only part, okay? So you have, of course, it starts with the overall picture of IPsec, which is the architecture. What are the components, which is coming in the next slide? What are the major components of IPsec? And basic security services that IPsec can provide and things like that. This is actually laid out in this RFC. And then in this architecture, they talk about two types of standards, which is the encapsulating security payload, ESP. So IPsec version 1 provides also what we call authentication header standards. So authentication is used for the authentication services, and the encapsulating security payload is used for encryption. So you are using two different standards to provide two different security services. However, in IPsec 2, they actually merged both in an ESP, and this AH, they deprecated. They have, but still they provided until today for backward compatibility. So you have the choice to use AH for providing authentication services and ESP for providing a encryption, okay? In that case, you end up with two different headers, one ESP header and one AH header, okay? Next to each other, okay? Or you can, in fact, remove this AH altogether and use ESP to provide both encryption and authentication, okay? Type. There's, of course, a standard document that lays out all the security mechanisms and algorithms used by IPsec or can potentially be used by IPsec, including by all the HMAC, all the encryption techniques, Diffie-Hellman, things like that, and also the pseudo-random functions which are used to possibly hash and generate keys. These mechanisms can be used by all these different standards for authentication, for encryption, things like that, okay? And of course, IKE is used to provide the what we call a security association, to create security association for any VPN tunnel or any IPsec tunnel. And that's detailed in a specific RFC, which is 7,000. Come on, of course, we don't have to memorize all these numbers yet. So we'll talk about security association. Security association is similar to CypherSpec. Remember the CypherSpec? So you have specific CypherSpec for a particular connection or a particular session. Okay, so that's security association. IPsec uses the term security association, which is exactly similar, but of course here security association, as we will see, contains by other fields and other information, which comes as an implication for the fact that IP itself is connectionless and it's unreliable. So we will see that in this security association, we need some fields or some parameters which are extra parameters other than for TLS and things like that. We need a local key, set of keys for authentication, for MAC, for encryption, and in here, but we need other fields which are to be used for the fact that IP is connectionless and unreliable, and we'll talk about these fields. So IKE itself has a database which is called the Security Association Database, and it manages this database to create new security association and put it in the database. This is very important. It's very important to know the difference between transport mode and tunnel mode. In the transport, so IPsec itself, whether that's ESP or AH, both of them, they can be used in a transport mode or tunnel mode, okay? So we need to know the difference between the two. For transport mode, it provides protection primarily to the upper layer protocols. Upper layer above IP, okay? Okay? So whether by TCP, UDP, whatever, but above IP. Okay? Examples include TCP, UDP, or ICMP. Okay? And typically used for end-to-end communication between two hosts. So if you want to establish a tunnel using IPsec from host for host-to-host communication, usually you use transport layer mode. In that case, as I said, so the packet, you have of course the payload from the application. This payload comes with TCP or UDP or whatever. Okay? So in the transport mode, what we will do is that we will put ESP right after this. Okay? And if we want, we can use also the AH, which is optional. Okay? AH here is optional and it's provided just for backward compatibility, right? And the rest, and the rest is the IP header.
The original one.
So in that case, ESP provides the A. خليها كده هنا عشان there's something here. We'll talk about it. Okay. So this whole thing is gonna be encrypted. Okay. So the payload and all the upper layer protocols will be encrypted.
Including the something?
Including that lower بسمي ESP trailer. ESP trailer. Okay, so we'll talk about that. ماشي كده؟ So that's the transport mode. Okay? So in that case, ESP in transport mode, يعني معناها ان هي it comes right after the transport layer protocols. That's what it means. Okay? And optionally authenticates the IP. So optional معناها ايه؟ That doesn't mean that authentication will not happen. Authentication is mandatory, but if ESP does not perform authentication, then AH will. Right? So here you have the AH. AH is for authentication. So either you provide encryption using ESP and authentication using AH, or both using ESP. Okay? واضح؟ طيب, in the tunnel mode, in that case, it's slightly different. So we'll not do this. What we will do is that we will add the IP, and then we will provide ESP, okay, after the IP header. We will encrypt the entire thing, including that thing, okay? We'll encrypt everything, including the IP header. And of course, in that case, routers, they will not be able to see the original IP header, right? So in that case, we will provide another outer IP header. Okay? And this tunnel mode is usually used to secure network-to-network communication or host-to-network communication. Okay? واضح كده؟ ماشي؟ So it provides protection to the entire IP packet. Entire معناها the payload, TCP, and the IP header as well, right? So of course, in this outer IP header, we don't necessarily have to use the ultimate destination address, by the way. We don't do that. اللي هو ايه؟ لا, مش next hub. Not the next hub. The IPsec network firewall on the other end. Right? So here, instead of routing to the ultimate destination, this outer IP header will include possibly the IP address of the firewall on the other end. On the destination firewall. To the destination, yani where this should be decrypted. Okay? After this is decrypted, خلاص بقى انت حر بقى, do whatever you want. And my job is done. My job is at the end of the tunnel. So this outer IP is the destination firewall or the destination router. Once it reaches that, it will be decrypted and then it will be sent over the other remote network. واضح كده؟
بالتنل مود وير از ذا اي اتش ات ويل ستي ان ذا
سيم. Yes, both ASP and AH they work in both. Tunnel or يعني actually the standard also mentions the fact that ASP can be done in tunnel and AH can be done in transport or the other way around. So the standard provides all flexibility. It does not dictate, and we'll talk about this more. So it does not dictate which one is done first.
In here it is the transport mode or the tunnel mode. Here it's talking about the AH. Then there's another.
No. Yes, well, here we did not. Did we mention here whether we're talking about ASP or AH?
No.
Both of them, they use both modes.
Okay.
Both of them, they use both. Okay, so you can use ASP here or here. You can use AH here or here.
Four modes.
Yes. So you have all the four combinations possible. Okay? Depending on the use case. Okay? So we'll talk even about the fact that you can have a tunnel which is composed of, you can have, sorry, a security, IP security association, which is composed of two, transport mode ESP and tunnel mode AH, or the other way around. Okay? So the standard does not dictate any particular scenario, whether you do the authentication first or you do the encryption first. Which is what we have discussed before. We said that we can possibly do one before the other. صح? We said that there is no particular benefit when it comes to doing authentication before encryption or encryption before authentication. There's no. But here, remember, transport mode and tunnel mode, there is a difference because in transport mode, we do not encrypt the IP header. So we leave it, in which case routers can do the routing based on the final destination address. Okay? In the tunnel mode, no. In the tunnel mode, we encrypt the IP header. In which case, routers, they rely on the outer IP header to perform routing. Confusion? Confused? Yes, the standard is complicated because it has lots of combinations and lots of things are interleaved together.
I have last question.
Yeah, tfaddal.
It says PSP, it's optionally authenticate the IP. This is because we have IPsec2, which is this used for authentication and the encryption. Yes, this is what does it mean?
Right. So IPsec2 provides how IPsec2 provides authentication as part of ESP.
So that's why it's said optionally.
Yes. Yes. But they made it optional. Why? To make it backward compatible with IPsec1, which requires AH as a separate component for authentication. Okay? So if you wanna use IPsec2 and stay backward compatible with IPsec1, okay, then you can use ESP and AH both to make sure that you are backward compatible with IPsec1. Otherwise, if that's not a requirement for you and you want to use IPsec2 and you are sure that on the other side they use IPsec2 as well,
you use
right?
ASP.
Then use ASP to provide both authentication and encryption. And in that case, there is no AH at all. But in that case, the authentication has to be done by ASP. Authentication has to be done regardless, whether it's using ESP or AH.
Yeah, it depends on the version.
It depends on the version, yes. But when we say it's optionally done, that doesn't mean that authentication may not be done. It has to be done by someone. It has to be done by something. The question is, who should do it? ESP or AH? Wow, كده. Okay? بلادي لسه confused. Things will become clearer. So that's what we discuss here. So again, AH, it authenticates the IP payload and selected portions of the IP header. selected portions. So
sometimes you will hide some parts and sometimes
you will expose. It says authenticate. Authenticate معناها it generates the MAC. Okay, it generates the message authentication codes. So that's the message authentication codes. This is encrypting, encrypted version of the signature. And the signature here is based on the IP payload or the IP payload plus some portions of the IP header. So that can be done, this is no problem. But in the transport mode, again, the header is still exposed. The header is still exposed, okay? In the tunnel mode, but authenticates the entire inner packet, including the IP header, okay? ESP, it encrypts the IP payload, and maybe IP version 6 extend, and I don't want to talk about IP version 6 when it comes to IPsec, because it will make things a lot more complicated. And I tried to يعني هو, the idea in general is that if you remember يعني from Network 1, when we discussed IP version 6, we discussed a field called next header. And we said that this next header actually provides sort of a recursive way of referring to the upper layer protocol. And this upper layer protocol could be actually IP version 4. Just for migrating between IP version 6 and IP version 4. Sometimes you have to yes. So you have to use extra encapsulation. Then this next header can in fact be a recursive linked list of different يعني protocols, which could be IP version 4 or ICMP or TCP or UDP. So in fact, IP version 6 provide not just one encapsulation for the network layer, it could be multiple. This is what we refer to as the header extensions for IP version 6. For header extensions, the next header can in fact refer to a linked list of different headers. يعني ما علينا, in general بقى, إن هو, it provides some extensions to the headers. These extensions might in fact be encrypted. Okay? So these header extensions might get encrypted even in the transport mode. But anyway, forget about IP version 6. I'm not gonna يعني, talk much about this. So just remember, it's simple for IP version 4, transport mode does not encrypt the original IP header. That's it, okay? So IP header is exposed, which is similar to TLS and things like that.
Yeah.
TLS does not encrypt the TCP header, right? So here it's the same, okay? Type. In the tunnel mode, we encrypt everything. But then routers, they will require the outer header.
Outer now, header. We said that AH and ECP can authenticate.
This ESP here, there is ESP with authentication. This is provided in IPsec 2.
But what about encryption? Encryption is also.
Oh, ESP is encryption.
Yes,
ESP mainly is for encryption.
But I mean, didn't we say that we can use only AH?
No. You cannot use AH alone. No.
Okay.
You cannot use AH alone. In IPsec 1, you have to use ESP for encryption, AH for authentication. Well, AH is optional. ESP is not optional. ESP header has to be there. The optional part is that ESP will still exist, but it may be used only for encryption or both for encryption and authentication. This is that third row. Okay? So in that third row, the ESP with authentication will perform both. Meshi will perform the authentication as well as the encryption. Meshi? So this is the architecture, which is laid out in one of the RFCs. So what's important for us to know is that we have what we call security policy database. And again, this is done why? This is done because of the fact that IPsec can be used to secure the entire network, right? So we have to have the choice that some of the traffic coming from this network should in fact use different security services, different types of security services, and sometimes even no security services. And maybe some of us have tried using VPN, okay? So in certain, if you try accessing some websites,
it will not go through
the VPN.
Port 80.
Yeah, it will not go through VPN, right? So VPN is already connected and everything is fine, but it doesn't go. Why? Because the policy database allows this type of traffic to be bypassed for different reasons, man. For different reasons. Sometimes because we don't want to replicate the job of TLS, okay? Because we know that this particular website is already secured through TLS and we don't want to replicate the job, so we can just bypass it, okay? And sometimes for other reasons. So even IKE uses specific types of messages through this. And these types of messages are bypassed from the tunnel. Okay? Yani for different reasons, we need certain types of traffic to be bypassed, or certain types of traffic to use specific security association. And by security association here, we mean the cipher spec, specific algorithm for encryption, specific algorithm for authentication, for integrity, for key management, and so on. Okay? Well, so this security policy database stores all the security associations for the different traffic. Okay? So the first entry point to this whole architecture, when a traffic comes to an IPsec entry point, okay, is first to look at this security policy database. Okay? So then if we see that there is a specific policy for that type of traffic, then this policy will point to a specific security association. And this security association is stored in this database. The details about this security association is stored in another database called the security association database. This security association database is where all the techniques, all the, you know, the cipher spec, all the algorithms for encryption, for authentication, for integrity, for whatever, for keys, all the keys and everything will be stored here. In the security policy database, all we need is just the primary key, because database is the primary key. Huh? So from the security policy database, we only need the primary key that points to the security association database. All of this we didn't have to do for TLS and SSL. Why? Because it's one application to one application. Right? So we don't have to do all this complexity. Here, we might be securing the entire network, which includes many hosts and many applications running on each host. So we have to have some kind of filtering. Okay? So that's what we have in this architecture. Of course, we have ESP, which is the basic BA tunnel, which provides by all the encryption. And we have the key management through IKE. Okay? So we'll talk about each component in this architecture in the coming slides. So that's the overall picture of IPsec. Well, any questions? So there is the concept of security association. Security association is one of the most important concepts in IPsec. It's a one way, and by one way here is very important. One way. Why one way? Because IPsec is connectionless. Is connectionless, okay? It's a context for one way, because IP there is no concept of connection. Even in TLS, TCP has a concept of connection, okay? So the cipher spec is for the bidirectional communication. Here we do not have bidirectional communication. Yani the context of a connection, right? So here it's one-way logical connection between a sender and a receiver that affords security services to traffic carried on it. In any IP packet, the security association is uniquely identified by these components. The most important one is what we call security parameter index. This is the primary key of the security association. This is actually stored both in the security policy database and also in the packet, in the header of ESP. Okay? So that's the identifier based on which we can select by the security association related to a particular IPsec packet or IPsec traffic. So, of course, there is the security protocol identifier, which includes that indicates whether this is just a flag that indicates whether we are using AH or ASP. Okay? And the IP destination address. This IP destination address, as we said, it could be the ultimate destination or it could be the firewall, the destination firewall IP. Okay? Where the end of the tunnel is. طيب. So the security association database defines, of course, the security association, as you can imagine, it's not only SPI, and so it has a bunch of other fields. So these fields are, for example, we have what we call the security parameter index, which is the primary key, as we said. And we have the sequence number counter, least sequence number.
To generate the master key?
لا لا.
أيوة.
Replay attack. Yes, to mitigate the replay attack. To mitigate the replay attack. Actually, in fact, again, you will see this is one of the implications of IP. Okay? In TLS, we did have something like this to mitigate replay attack. If you go back, you will see that. However, here in IP, we have three fields, actually. We have three fields to mitigate replay attack. We have sequence number, we have counter overflow, and we have anti-replay window. So we have three different fields to mitigate replay attack. Why not one? That's one of the applications of the fact that IP does not have a connection and it's unreliable. Okay, because of this, a packet with a specific counter or a specific sequence is not guaranteed to reach first in order, right? Because we don't have a connection. In TCP, we have a connection, and TCP is underneath. It will ensure the order of the segments delivered on the other side before they go, right? Here, we don't have this. IP does not provide any guarantees. Neither order nor actually receiving the packet at all, right? Yani a packet may be dropped.
Yes.
It's best effort, right? So a packet which is sent with a specific sequence does not have to actually arrive on the other side with that sequence, right? So in that case, we'll have to use a window technique similar to the window technique that's used. Window technique is used in many things, okay? So here in IPsec, we use window technique. So we will allow the sequence number to range between minimum and maximum of a window. As long as this sequence number is within this window, we will allow it. We will consider that there is no replay attack or any suspicion for replay attack. Okay? And that's, again, one of the implications of the fact that IP is connectionless and unreliable. If it's outside the window, okay, there is a condition. If it's outside, or if it's inside, but it was marked as received, we'll see that, then something fishy is happening. In that case, we may, in fact, send a sequence counter overflow. We may send, some kind of a reset counter message to say, no, this security association seems to be breached and we need to reset it, or we need to reset the counter, we need to start from the beginning so that we mitigate the replay attack. Okay, so that the replay attack mitigation here is done using these three fields, not just one. Okay, it was simple in TLS because of the fact that TCP is connection oriented and it's guaranteed. Okay, we did not study, by the way, datagram TLS. We did not study that. Datagram TLS provides security services over UDP. It's called DTLS. We did not study that. That TLS security protocol has to use a different mitigation for replay attack other than the, because again, TCP is connection oriented. So the mitigation for the replay attack is easy. I'm expecting one sequence and one sequence only every time. Because everything is in order, right? Everything is in order. Here, I cannot guarantee that.
Yeah, it is an
assignment.
It's mentioned the datagram.
Yes, datagram TLS, right. Yes. Type. In addition, we have the AH information and we have ESP information. AH information includes the information regarding authentication, and ESP requires or includes the encryption information. And that this is the lifetime of this security association. So just the fact that there is no suspicious behavior with a replay attack, it doesn't mean that we can use the security association forever. No, there is also a lifetime for this security association, even for the same traffic. Even for the same traffic. And again, we have used that many times when we talked about the temporal keys. And so you always have to renew the security association and provide some refreshment to your security parameters every now and then, okay? And there is the flag that we talked about, IP sec protocol mode, whether you're using tunnel mode or transport mode, okay? And there is the path MTU. This is the maximum transmission unit, okay? That one is a bit interesting because we have learned MTU is hub by hub, right? So you have, like for example, you have router, and then you have another router, and so on. So each of these hubs, they may in fact use a different network access technology. Like for example, this could be Ethernet, this could be wireless, right? This could be fiber optics, okay? So from one hub to another, if the MTU changes, okay, if the MTU gets smaller, what do?
Fragmentation.
Fragmentation. We call it fragmentation, okay? Fragmentation in IPsec, it's done, but it complicates things even more, okay? It can be done, but what they normally do is that they use some kind of a path MTU. So it's like you select the smallest MTU, okay, so that inside the tunnel you can do one fragmentation before the tunnel, and then after the tunnel you can do by the defragmentation and send it. Okay? So this is not hub MTU, this is path MTU. From the beginning to the end of the tunnel, it goes through multiple network access technology. So I select one MTU for the entire path. And I can store it here.
The smallest MTU?
Typically the smallest MTU, because, yes, because if you use the smallest MTU, then you cannot, you don't have to do fragmentation along the path. Because you do fragmentation when? If the packet is like 2,000 bytes, and then the MTU is 1,000 bytes, so what do?
You have to
break it down into two segments, or two fragments, right? We want to avoid doing this inside the tunnel. Okay? So we use in that case one MTU, one path MTU. And that's part of the security association. Any question? So all these fields are used in the security association. Type. The security policy database, as we said, this is like the overall guard of IPsec, if you will. So the means by which IP traffic is related to specific security association. So the policy database stores the connection between the incoming traffic and the security association. And this kind of mapping, okay, happens based on certain criteria that's stored by in the security association database. Could be based on the destination address of the ultimate host or the network. Could be based on port. Could be based on username. okay, or a combination of all of these. And you can use wildcards and you can use all of this, okay? In more complex environment, there may be multiple entries that potentially relate to a single security association. So multiple traffic can be mapped to the same security association, okay? Or multiple traffic can be mapped to different security associations. Both are possible. So each security policy database entry is defined by a set of IP and the upper layer protocol, okay, field values, and which are called selectors. These selectors are the criteria based on which I will select a specific security association and assign it to a particular incoming IP traffic. Okay? These are what we call selectors. These are used to filter the outgoing. By outgoing here, we mean the outgoing from the entry firewall or the host and going out to the core network. Okay? Type. This is the A. These are the fields that could be used as part of these selectors. It could be the remote IP address. So in that case, all the traffic that is going to that IP address, to the ultimate host, they will use specific security association. Or the local IP address, all the traffic that is coming from this host will in fact use this security association. Or all the traffic that uses, for example, UDP, or uses a specific ICMP, or something like this, they can use a specific security association. Okay? The name of the user, or local and remote ports. So you can associate a security association to a particular application, okay, for using the local ports and the remote ports. Any questions so far? طبعاً, of course, needless to say that you can use a combination of all of these, and we'll see that here. So for example, I'm here, the first row here says that if you use UDP from that particular IP address on that particular port, which uses that particular remote port, what is the action? Bypass.
Normal.
So just pass this over IP directly, because this is in fact IKE traffic. This is in fact used for key management and distribution. So in that case, I don't want to use the tunnel service for this. This is actually used for key management and distribution. Type ICMP coming from this host using wildcard, which means any port, which will also a bypass for sending error messages, and so on. So you can use any combinations of these criteria. I could actually use here, like for example, TLS, and say also bypass. When I say protect, okay, and I say protect here, ESP transport mode, ESP tunnel mode. I have the option to protect it using tunnel mode or transport mode. This is actually one checkbox in your VPN client. If you look at that, if you look at the IP configuration, sorry, the configuration for any VPN client, clients, they give you access to provide either transport mode or tunnel mode or something like this. So at least we know, we understand that now what that means. Mashika? Type. So certain traffic will be completely discarded. That's what happens possibly to our traffic when we try to access servers inside QU. Sometimes we get rejected, okay? Yeah, and so, sorry?
Yeah, and why is the ICMP giving us an error message? Is it because of a specific value?
No, the ICMP is for sending error messages.
Oh, yes. Oh.
Yeah, the ICMP is for sending error messages. Like, for example, when you, for example, for trace route or for ping or something like this, sometimes you get error messages. Right?
When you can't reach.
Yes, when you can't reach, or when the TTL goes to zero for the case of trace route, things like that. So you can send error messages in that case. Okay. So in that case, if that's for this particular host, you can send it using IP normally, not using any ESP or any AH protection.
The ICMP error message, does it mean that because from any port to any
So this, for outgoing traffic, by outgoing traffic here, we mean that this is a host or a firewall, and there's incoming traffic coming from. يعني let me طبعا draw it عشان بس ما يبقاش فيه. So you have a network here, and here you have like a firewall or a router that's running IPsec. You have a traffic, IP traffic coming from the network. And this IPsec by this is what we call outgoing. Okay? So for this outgoing traffic, what is the logic? What is the algorithm? Okay? So that's what we do here. So first, when we have an outgoing incoming IP packet coming, whether it's coming using by a TCP, UDP, with a specific port number, so all of this is available for us. Yani assuming that we have the ability to read by the TCP header because it's not encrypted yet, okay? First, we search the policy database to try to find a match for the criteria inside this packet. If we find a match, then we determine the policy. If the policy is to protect, we do the tunneling, we do the protection, and we try to use the security association. If we if the action is to bypass, then we'll send it right away over IP. But here, by this protection, we mean that in this at this point we have the SPI, the security policy index, okay, or the security parameters index. We use this SPI to search in the security association database. So there is a possibility that we have a match, in which case we already have the security association with all its parameters. So we'll use these parameters and we protect the traffic. We use ballet, AH, ASP, whether in tunnel mode, transport mode, whatever, and then we'll send this over IP and everything's good, okay? If we don't have a match, then we go to IKE. We go to IKE to establish a new security association. Okay? Because there is a chance that, okay, you have the policy, you know what to do with the traffic, but this is the first packet that is coming from that traffic, and there is no security association done yet for this traffic, in which case, we go back through IKE, and we'll study that. We will go through IKE to establish the security association for the first time.
But shouldn't it loop back into the block for the IKE?
Mahua, this is done for one packet.
Then you will find it.
Yeah, it's, so implicitly it loops through all the packets, it performs this for one particular packet.
Okay.
Taban, of course, if there is no policy, we discard. Okay, so any traffic has to be, it has to have a policy.
By default.
There's no policy, and that's why we need to have, in the policy database, we usually have some kind of a default policy or wildcard or something that can be used in case of a traffic that is, yani, by default. Okay, so if we don't have that policy in the policy database, we discard the traffic. In the incoming path, now we have a packet that it's coming in. Coming in where? Coming in on the destination firewall or the destination IPsec for the host. So first, we identify, because there is a chance that this packet was bypassed, which means that it's sent over IP directly. So if that's the case, then it goes through that branch. And for IPsec, we try to make sure that this IP is to be bypassed. Okay? So we search the security policy database to make sure that this IP is meant to bypass. If that's the case, then we will deliver it to the upper layer. If that's not meant to be bypassed, in which case we'll discard.
Okay, policy here and here.
Yes, of course. If it's protected by through IPsec, then we search the a security association. This that security association is for by decryption وكذا, an association, sorry, an authentication end-to-end. So using by this security association, we can by decrypt the message, we can verify the MAC, we can do all the anti-replay mitigation for the replay attack and so on. Then we process the AH or ASP header and then we go to the upper layer. طب عبد الهادي عمل لي بس ساعة فاحنا ايه. Okay, so moving on. So this is the anti-replay mechanism. So this is the anti-replay mechanism. So the for any window technique, what we need to understand is that what is the action to be taken if a received packet is outside this window, inside this window, what do we do? Okay? So basically, you are allowed to receive a packet within the anti-replay. Usually, by the way, the size, this size is 64 packets. Okay? And again, this is done through some experiments. And the idea here is that, yani, if you receive packets outside of 64, this means that your IP is extremely unreliable. Yani, so there is some extent to how unreliable IP is. So typically, 64 is good enough to account for the unordered packets from IP. So if you receive a packet here, in way in the past, طبعاً of course this is rejected, تمام. Okay, so something in the past, so this means that this packet is an error or it's a replay attack or something like this. So if you receive a packet within the window, by the way, by receiving a packet means that this is a new packet and it's authenticated. This is very important, which means that the MAC has been verified. Okay, MAC has been verified. This is very important, okay? So if the MAC has been verified and the packet is new and it's within the window, then if it's marked as not received, then we accept it, okay? Which means that we'll decrypt it and we'll send it up, and then we will mark this packet as received, okay? If it's marked as received, okay, then this packet will be discarded, and in that case, but you have the choice to do the counter overflow and to do the job maybe there is something suspicious, and you can reset by the security association, and you can renew the security association, or you can reset the counter and so on. Okay, but what if it's here? If it's in the future, yes, if it's something in the future, what do you do? In that case, you slide the window, because remember, replay attack is for something in the past, okay? If it's something in the future and the packet is new, authenticated, so that's a valid traffic, okay? So that's the condition based on which you slide the window up, okay? So here, you slide the window to the right. Yeah, so that's a good question. So if you slide the packet and you still have some packets, this is your question, right? You still have some packets here that are not received. That's probably because of some unreliable IP problem, right? So this packet most probably is not received, is lost. TTL is zero and one of the routers decided to drop it, things like that. And دوارد طبعاً, it's valid, right? So, but there is no replay attack for something in the future. So if a packet is new and it's authenticated, the message authentication code is verified, so that's a valid packet and it's a new packet and it's still in the future. So you slide the window, okay? You slide the window to indicate that, okay, so now, the window has slid, and all the packets inside this window will be processed based on whether they are received or not. Nashika, you seem suspicious.
Yeah,
Yeah, yeah.
And so it is in the future in reference to the window itself.
Right, right.
But inside the window command, you receive a packet that has an empty space that has never received before.
Mm-hmm. So you accept it.
Also,
yes, there is future. Yes, there is future. It is future.
Two-way future and right. Near future.
Yes, but there has to be a mechanism based on which we slide the window.
Yes.
For any window technique, there has to be a way for you to know when you slide the window.
Okay.
So the logic here, the يعني مثلا in data link layer, remember network 2 when we started, what is the criteria to slide the window? When you receive contiguous set of packets, then you always have to slide the window until the packet that is not received yet, right? So that's the logic. So you have to have a logic based on which you slide the window. For any window mechanism, that's what you do, right? So here, the mechanism for sliding the window is when you receive a future packet that's outside the window.
That's specifically okay. N+1.
Yes, N+1, yes, N+1, right. So N+1, then you slide the window.
But it should be authenticated.
It should be new packet and MAC is verified. Okay? N+2, N+3, yani in this?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's uncommon, but yeah, in theory, you should, in that case, you should also slide the window.
Slide?
Yes.
If I'm an attacker, then I replay attack.
A replay attack is there for something in the future. Replay, ma'naha. You have taken a copy of a packet in the past that was sent in the past, and then you replay it. That's what you do.
You guarantee what is this packet already reached the destination before you replay it? Well, it didn't reach the destination.
You don't have to guarantee whether it reached or not, but you capture you capture a copy of the packet because this copy of the packet contains MAC. And if you get the same copy of the packet, then you ensure that this MAC is verifiable. Okay, it's verifiable, right? Then you take this copy of the packet and then you send it again. Okay?
You cannot guarantee what is...
Yeah, so in that case, MAC can be verified. Mm-hmm. MAC will be verified.
Yes.
And for us, it's considered to be a new packet. Okay? But if it's way in the past, chances are by, this is clear replay attack. So it's a clearly replay attack because it's way in the past.
Yeah.
Well, the idea is that if it's within the window, and why window again? Because of the fact that IP does not guarantee ordering of how and when you receive the packets. So packets may arrive unordered.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's why we have to have a window, not just one packet we expect. Okay. So the mechanism again to slide the window is when you receive a packet that has a verifiable MAC, and it's a new packet and it's in the future. Okay? So you can receive N+2, you slide the window, and N+1 here will be marked as not received. So that's fine. That's okay. Okay. Mashaka? Type. These are both So for transport layer security, by transport layer security here, we mean that we have a host-to-host transport mode tunnel, okay? As we said, transport mode is usually used for host-to-host secure communication, and in that case, we have the security association for the logical connection, not taban, yeah, it's not a connection, but you have the security association for the secure communication going from one host to another, regardless of whatever applications are running on that host. So all the applications on that host, they will inherit this security association for the entire traffic, with the different taban security policies. As we said, in different traffic can be associated with the same security association. Different types of traffic can be associated to the same security association. So we can say that all the traffic coming from that host, they will go to one security association. We can do that, okay? Or different types of traffic, they can go through different security association, okay? So this is for the transport. For the tunnel mode, we secure network-to-network communication. So this is the tunneling service, okay? So in that case, we have ASP and or AH for the tunnel mode. In that case, the payload and the original header, both of them, they will be encrypted. So encapsulation, this is how it, so in terms of encapsulation for the transport mode, I omitted, by the way, the IPv6 here. It's because IPv6 is a lot more complicated, so I removed it. Okay, so this is the IP packet. Okay, so for the transport mode, the ESP header comes right after the upper layer protocols, whether this is TCP, ICMP, UDP, whatever. Okay, but then the original IP is exposed. Okay, and this is the encrypted part. What is this bad? Huh? This ESP trailer. Huh? What is this? We talked about this. This is about the something that I mentioned at the beginning. What is it? Huh?
I'm not sure. Do you know what it is like?
Be confident. Aywa? This is ESP trailer. What does it represent? Why was it?
Do you know it is like, it is coming after TCP and it's including encryption or not? And is it in the Mac or like?
No, this is the Mac. This is the Mac. So ESP authentication. So ESP authentication, if it's used, it's used there.
Padding,
can
you guess?
Huh?
Padding, because it's
padding, aywa kida, aywa, sah kida. This is padding. Padding for a? For a? For what?
The data.
Yeah. No, padding has nothing to do with the data. Padding is
to confuse
the to confuse the traffic analysis.
Yes.
To change the size of the packet randomly so that we make the traffic analysis much harder. Okay? So this is padding. Okay? Right. So the padding together with the payload and the upper layer header, they will be all encrypted, and then the authentication will happen for the entire thing. So for this, we encrypt first, and then we create the MAC based on the entire thing. طبعاً, you have the option to do the other way around. You first create the authentication, the MAC, okay, from the unencrypted data, and then encrypt the whole thing. You can do either, okay? But in the transport mode, the main thing to remember is that the original IP header is already there, so the ultimate destination IP address is already there, so you can use it for routing. Routers are happy. There's no confusion for the routers, and they can perform routing, and transport mode is very transparent to the routers. They have no effect on the routers. Type. In the tunnel mode, the ESP will come after the original IP header, and in which case the entire IP header and the payload are going to be encrypted. Okay, and in that case you have a new IP header, and this new IP header contains not necessarily the ultimate destination IP address, but the destination firewall. Okay, and that will be used by the intermediate routers to provide the routing hub by hub. هنا لا هنا ما فيش هنا. This is ASP. ASP is used for this particular protocol data unit. We're using ASP both for encryption and authentication. Yes, which is done as part of IPsec. How the encapsulation is done. Which is clear, yeah. What we do is that for the transport mode, we take both the data and the TCP header, and then we encrypt both. Okay, we add the original. Yeah, and this is the original header for IP. For IPsec, we add the ESP in between, and we encrypt this entire TCP and the data. And of course, but this, by the way. The encryption is done for the trailer as well. And the ESP trailer, again, is for padding, okay? And padding is part of the encrypted payload. And then we add the authentication MAC. For the tunnel mode, we do multiple encapsulations in that case. for the this is the IP PDU, and then we add the ESP header, and then encrypt everything until here, including the IP header, and then we add the outer IP header for facilitating the routing up by up. Okay, so that's the difference between transport type. For ESP with authentication option in this approach back, the first user applies ESP to the data to be protected and then appends the authentication data field to it. This is the more common scenario. You provide ESP, you encrypt, and then you calculate the MAC based on the encrypted data. Okay? You calculate the MAC based on the encrypted data. The transport mode ESP, the authentication and encryption apply to IP payload delivered to the host, but the IP header is not protected, is exposed. In the tunnel mode, the authentication applies to the IP header delivered to the outer IP destination address, and the authentication is performed at that destination. Okay? Local destination firewall. Okay? And the entire IP packet, including the header, will be protected. For both cases, authentication applies to the ciphertext rather than the plaintext. واضح كده؟ اللي هو الاوثنتيكيشن اللي هو الماك. ماك is calculated based on the ciphertext, on the encrypted payload or encrypted payload and the header in the case of the tunnel mode. ماشي؟ Is there a restriction to do that? No. There is also the flexibility of doing the authentication or the MAC based on the unencrypted payload. That's also possible. Okay? And in fact, in the standard, they mention some benefits to that. Although I disagree with these benefits, and we'll see that. There is about the transport adjacency. Another way to apply authentication after encryption, okay, is to use two bundled transport. Yeah, this is by. This is interesting in that case. Use two bundled transport service security associations. Yeah, meaning you have two types of security associations. One for ESP and one for AH. So if you use AH together with ESP, then you may have actually two bundled. They call them bundled security associations. You have two security associations. Because you can use different specs or different algorithms for encryptions for encryption other than the encrypting the MAC. So you can use, for example, for encryption, you can use, AES or something like that. But for MAC, you use public key or private key, okay? Or use certificates, okay? So in that case, you can use different. So in each. For ESP, use security association, and for AH, use different security association. So in this case, ASP is used without authentication. Okay? And you have a service, you have a security association for ESP, and then you have a security association for AH, which are two different things. In that case, you have what we call a bundled security association. So you have two security associations. Okay? Type. The advantage of this approach is that the authentication covers more fields. So in that case, if you use AH, okay, if you use AH after ESP, AH can in fact calculate the MAC based on the encrypted payload and the header and some fields of ESP. Okay? Yeah, and that's what this means. So the authentication can, in fact, also ensure the integrity, not that of the payload, but also the integrity of the ESP header itself. Okay? If the AH is done external from ESP. Okay? So this is the advantage. However, as I said, this advantage has been removed for the case of IPsec2, and IPsec2 uses ESP for both encryption and authentication, there is no need for AH in that case.
So it was more secure then?
Using AH and not really. Yeah, this advantage is not really significant, يعني, because يعني what he's trying to do here is that if we have two different headers, then we can use the AH header to ensure the integrity of the ESP header. Okay, but if we have the ESP header only for both, then we actually we don't have to have the overhead of including actually the ESP header for calculating the MAC. That's why there is a disadvantage, is that the overhead for two bias security associations. If you have two types, the ESP and the AH, then you end up with two security associations. Okay, and that's an overhead. That's an overkill, right? So that's the advantage of having ESP for both authentication and encryption, and in that case you can end up with only one security association. It's simple and it's not really يعني, more secure in the case of AH. But the only advantage for using AH is that AH can calculate the MAC based on the sum of the ESP header fields, which ensures the integrity of the ESP header fields. That's the only advantage. This is interesting. This is about when you have a combination of transport tunnel. So you can have ESP based on transport layer, based on transport mode, and AH based on tunnel mode. Okay? Or you can have the other way around. You can have the authentication first, okay, calculating the MAC based on transport mode, which means that you calculate the MAC based on the payload and the TCP header only, okay? But then when you use ESP, use it for the tunnel. So you can have all the combinations, okay? So the use of authentication, وبقى هنا بيهايلايت بقى. There is some advantage which I don't, يعني صراحة buy so much. There is some advantage for the use of authentication prior to encryption, okay? اللي هو it might be preferable for some reasons. ايه بقى الريزنز؟ يعني هو بيقول ان هو instead of doing the MAC, calculating the MAC based on the ciphertext, which is what we discussed before, we can in fact perform the MAC first before we cipher everything. ماشي؟ As we discussed before, we can do it in any order, right? It doesn't matter. But here he's trying to say that, yeah, there is some advantage to this. Why? Because it's impossible for anyone to intercept the message and alter the authentication data without detection. So he's saying that it's impossible for anyone to intercept the message and alter the authentication data. So in that case, if you encrypt everything, you don't have access to the MAC, right?
Yes.
Because it's already encrypted, okay? So that's one advantage. The other advantage is that it may be desirable to store the authentication information, layer MAC, and the unciphered text or the plain text. You store it for future record. Okay? Why would I do that? يعني, why do you need to do this? Well, what he's saying here is that the MAC is calculated for the plain text, right? And then you encrypt everything. So it may be desirable to say, oh, okay, so this plain text has this MAC and store both. The only reason for this is that if you want to send the same plain text so you can get the MAC from the cache and instead of calculating it again. That's the only advantage I can see. Other than this, there's no particular, because if it's encrypted, every time you have to eat, To do it for the encrypted message, which will be different keys and stuff, so you have to calculate the MAC every time. But if you do the MAC for the plain text, then if you have it stored in the cache, then you can get it. It's not يعني, really a big advantage. Okay? But in any case, the standard does not restrict the fact that you do the authentication, either to the plain text, and in which case you encrypt the whole thing, or you encrypt first, and then you do the authentication for the encrypted message. If you do the authentication for the encrypted message, you cannot do that, of course. You cannot store بقى the plain text. It's not plain text, so it's encrypted. Okay. So anyway, all the combinations are possible. يعني. Okay. طيب. One approach is to use bundle consisting of an inner AH transport security association and an outer ESP tunnel. That's what I said. Okay. So all the combinations are possible. So you do inner AH, which means that you calculate the MAC based on what? Based on the payload and the TCP header only. Okay? And then you add the original IP header, and then you encrypt the whole thing using ESP, and then you provide the outer IP header. You can do all types of combinations. This concept will allow you to generate some nested tunnels like this. So you can have multiple. So you can have here, مثلاً, you can have transport mode, okay, using AH for authentication, ESP for encryption, okay, which means that you end up with two different security associations, host to host, using transport mode, using a two security associations, okay. So that's one scenario. The other scenario, if you use transport mode, in that case, you could use only ESP with authentication, which means one security association in the tunnel mode. Okay? So in that case, you can use only one security association using ESP for both encryption and authentication in the tunnel mode. Okay? Which means that this network could have unprotected traffic. This network could have unprotected traffic, but this tunnel secures both network-to-network communication. You can have some nested tunnels like this. So you can have one security association for the enterprise, from network to network, to secure, for Microsoft two offices, You can have a tunnel between the two offices using one tunnel security association, possibly using ESP for both encryption and association. On top of this, you can also use host-to-host, okay, on another security association, either using ESP or using ESP and AH, in which case you end up with one or more security association. So in that case, there is a tunnel between these two sites or two firewalls or two routers, okay? And from host to host, you have another security association or possibly more than security association if you were to use ESP and AH, okay? Which means, I'm not sure if you have tried this. I tried this before and it works fine. Yani you can have a VPN connection on top of a VPN tunnel. You can have that. You can do that. There's no restriction here. Okay, so you can secure a host over another tunnel from a firewall to a firewall. You could do that. The same scenario can happen if you are trying to access the service of QU, from outside. So instead of two offices, you have one host trying to access a remote network, and in that case as well, you can have a tunnel mode between the host and the network of QU, okay? And also, you can have another transport mode tunnel between that host and a specific host inside that network, okay? Which means, you are trying to access a particular server inside QU, okay? So you can have first a VPN connection with QU, in order to be able to see the servers inside. And then to connect to a server inside QU, you need to have a transport mode tunnel as well, okay? In addition to the QU tunnel to access that particular server. So in all these scenarios, in case one, case three, case four, you end up with multiple security associations, more than one security association. Could be two, could be three. Okay? And that's perfectly possible. So in other words, يعني the standard gives you ultimate flexibility, and that creates some kind of complexity actually in the standard. Another dimension that really complicates the standard is also the fact that since you are securing a network with potentially more than one host, with potentially hundreds of applications, right? So you need to have these policies, and you need to filter traffic based on certain policies. So the concept of policy database, security association for the different, we did not have that in TLS or SSL, okay? The other dimension that also complicated the standards even more is the fact that IP is by default a connectionless and unreliable, so mitigating something like replay attack requires a window technique rather than just a simple sequence number and so on. Yeah. So this is the internet key exchange, which is, we'll discuss next time.